It's the stories of Crosser and the people.
And I was interested in book design. I was interested in interactivity through books. I was interested in artist books. I was also interested in electronic media. And at a kind of a nexus point among these interests, I ended up thinking about video games. I wasn't very much a fan of existing video games. So I thought that I would try to do something with video games and try to see if it would be possible to carry weighty subject matter in video games. But I had an opportunity to work with some very gifted graduate students and collaborate with some very gifted graduate students who also wanted to learn how to make video games. So the video game was a collaboration, and it was a conversation among the collaborators. And so we were all trying to ensure that each layer or each facet or each dimension would reinforce and contribute to the artfulness. In the sort of nerdy way, we were doing homage to 8-bit graphics, but these are actually probably more 16-bit graphics, right? And so that refers to how many colors one would have access to. What is the size of your palette? And since these are two-dimensional games that were being crafted at the moment when the avant-garde was trying to figure out how to do 3D modeling and 3D animation, they're kind of a throwback, even before the nostalgia for 8-bit games had started. And so there was a little bit of an aesthetic risk there, or an attempt to signal to those who had played those games that there was a resonance or a harmonic being set up for them. We had conversations about older games. With Crosser, we didn't know how to make a fun game. We knew that Frogger was fun and financially, commercially successful. It was still the most commercially successful video game in history. In video games, what the player does is called a video game mechanic. And so we thought about what the player does. Is there art in there? Is there critique in what we've asked the player to do and what the player does do by interacting with the game system? It's an attempt to make art or do the things that art does through video game. What we did was we did a clever, sort of a clever thing. We took the underlying gameplay of Frogger, noticed that there was a kind of dynamic at work at the US-Mexico border that was very similar. And so if we changed a cute brown person for the cute green frog that is inside of Frogger, we would effectively duplicate that dynamic that was existing at that moment in time at Ciudad Juárez and El Paso, and maybe a few other points along the Rio Grande. We were thinking about telling a story through the video game, or making representations and signals through the video game to people that lived along the US-Mexico border, but in particular to those who were living and working at Juarez and El Paso. This was another response to a dynamic and a tendency in the academy. There's an academic field of inquiry called border studies. And it turns out that the majority of the scholarship that was being published on border studies was coming from San Diego, Tijuana. And so it would tell the stories of San Diego, Tijuana, and project that as the reality for all of the rest of the US-Mexico border. Myself and my collaborators wanted to tell a story that was of the region. And we wanted to tell it with people who were from the region. I was a guide, I'm not from the region. And so it was important to me that the collaborators that were. You know, I had the idea they all agreed, but I wanted to subsume my identity into this collaborative identity, and we called it SWEC. It would be the Southwest Enclave or Ensemble, is more accurately, the Southwest Ensemble for Art and Technology. The project that we collaborated on prior to making the game was the crafting of a collaborative digital video. for the aggressively boring film festival. And the curator of that film festival set up an aesthetic saying, like, look, bandwidth is really expensive. Don't put any credits on your film. You send that in as a text file that goes with. That aesthetic held over when we made Crosser. It's like, well, we'll put a title screen, because it's got to have a title screen. All of the game will appear on one window, and then there'll be an outcome screen, a victory condition. And so we were trying to make it as compact as possible. We were also trying to compress the time frame. We did it in about somewhere between 6 and 8 weeks. And so I taught two people how to program. A couple of people already knew how to do pixel art. And so I provided them with the sketches and the design document. And we all worked together from those materials. Especially for La Migra, the second video game, where you play as an immigration and naturalization of a service agent, who is now called an ICE agent. Back then it was INS. When you put the player in that role, traditionally video games have demonized the opponent, and part of that demonization is to render them homogenous and faceless, so that one doesn't have to bear the emotional load of killing them when one does. I decided that if we were going to put the player in the role of an INS agent, then each one of the invaders was going to be individuated. We would have a backstory for each one. It was based similar to the relationship between Crosser and Frogger. I wanted to base this one on some other antecedent, because that also became a kind of a commentary. And so the antecedent was Space Invaders. You can see the mechanic. It was less faithful to its antecedent than Crosser is. And so rather than having the aliens all be anonymous, they all have personality. Rather than having them move in lockstep, they have they move at their own rhythm, so as to give them back their humanity, or maintain them, that humanity. It's not a gift. It was inalienable, right? So to not alienate that. And I playfully call them aliens because of the discourse around immigration. And so each one of those characters had an identity. At first, there was Carlos Moreno. So he was the protagonist, and he's billed as a protagonist on both Crosser and La Migra. And part of the idea was also an homage to Charles Schulz and Peanuts. Carlos came about as I was trying to think about how the narratives around immigration and border crossing would be different if the person was thought of as a cute individual with a kind of a very heart tugging at your heartstrings kind of story. There was Carlos Moreno, which is a transliteration of Charles Brown. I adopted it, but I flipped the color palette on it. So Carlos wears a green shirt with a purple zigzag pattern. And so then, after having dreamed of Carlos Moreno, and I was like, well, I have to populate this universe. And so I will populate the universe with the cacahuates, which is also a translation of peanuts. And so each of the characters is a member of the cacahuates. There has to be a character who would be his Lucy. And so we have Maria Lucia de Pieles. She's the female figure made out of the pixel blocks upstairs. She's the central figure in the Flight from Egypt panel. So she wears a light blue wipi, which is the indigenous traditional dress that has an embroidered bodice. De pieles means band pelt, or of pelts. So she's Lucy band pelt. She's Maria Lucia de Pieles. Her brother, Linus, is Lino, which is translation is linen. But so he's standing next to her there. He's got this, his blanket is a serape. The serape is a poncho. We might use the word poncho, or poncho. Serape is a woven cloth that you carry around with you because you might need to put something between you and the load that you're carrying, or it might be cold. And so it's both functional and it expresses a kind of a cultural heritage because of the patterns by which it's woven have some kind of expression. We have Ish Dvorav, the militant Mayan troubadour. Is in the middle panel on this side. It's a death scene of the militant Mayan troubadour. And he might have come from Guatemala or Belize. I left his actual point of origin a little more uncertain, but certainly from southern Mexico or south of Mexico. And he was chased out of his homeland because he was too much of an activist. We also have analogs for Sally and the Peppermint Patty and for Marcy. So Sally Brown, she's also Moreno, is her last name. Patricia La Machona. La Machona means she's not very feminine, she's kind of macho. And so she's dressed in a Mexican soccer jersey. And so in Charles Schulz had her play, you know, she's an ace baseball player, but in my universe, she's an ace soccer player. And back then, it was still sort of like, what? Women's playing soccer? Huh. I said, yeah, why not? There's a line drawing that I think is in the show of Marcy, or I call her Marcia. In the Peanuts, she's not as clearly drawn, but except it's being her friendship with Patty. And so here she's Patty's friend, but she's also of a very particular type that would be seen in Mexico City and along the U.S.-Mexico border aspirationally. So a woman who would always wear her very slick back, very, very tight, she's thin as a rail. And she was always very, very fashionably dressed. And she was a photography student, and she was doing an art project, this photo documenting everything that's going on in the U.S.-Mexico border.
There's this also interesting thing, by centering the games at that sort of quarter mile of that particular place in the border. So there, 60% of the population of UTEP would study, would lived in Juarez and would study in UTEP.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
I had students who would commute daily. That was just part of their daily existence, just across the border. Because you had two very large metropolitan areas that were right up against each other. She could easily have been a UTEP student. Marcia could have been a UTEP student who lived in Juarez and was studying art. And it took me a while. I realized, so in Crosser, there isn't death. Well, death is represented because there's a cadaver that floats down the Rio Grande. But the player character cannot die, nor can any of the other non-player characters. But in La Migra, death had to be modeled. It was a very real possibility. And it took me a lot of time to build up the emotional strength to draw the death masks of all the characters. I came to love it. It was hard.
There is one panel where all of the women characters appear, and it's the one that is about the femicides.
Oh,
and so the death mask of all of the women characters borders the posts that attempts to give homage to the femicides. The femicides didn't make it into the games. We were a little bit clueless at that point in time as to what was happening at Juarez.
Several thousand women disappeared in Ciudad Juarez, and their bodies were found mutilated and naked in the desert.
There was no news stories about it until much, much later. The police weren't investigating. Artists began to make protest and commentary by painting either a black rectangle with a pink cruciform on posts or a pink rectangle with a black cruciform. This is very, very rapid graffiti style interventions onto the urban landscape.
The government wouldn't acknowledge that these women had disappeared, wouldn't investigate, because it wasn't investigated at the time. People were left to make conjectures.
These factories, these maquilas, would employ women because they were thought to be more docile, more willing to follow orders and such. They opened up along the U.S.-Mexico border, and so that changed the nature of economic opportunity throughout Mexico. So places like Juarez became an attractor for people who were looking for economic opportunity across Mexico. Not necessarily as a staging point to cross, but because the jobs were there. And the fact that they were employing women instead of men meant that the women became the providers and the men were not being able to find employment. And so that turned upside down the paternalist culture that had existed in Mexico. This was a Warner Brothers cartoon, and this was the director for this one was Robert McKimson, and often the directors have a hand in writing. This one, this piece says for Ezequiel Hernandez, who on the 20th of May 1997 was shot and killed by U.S. Marines as he tended his flock. His family owned land. He was a U.S. citizen. And his family's land was on the U.S. side of the U.S.-Mexico border near Redford, Texas. Marines said that they were being shot at by some cartel members. And they shot him with, you know, Ezequiel had a .22 caliber rifle that he used to ward off coyotes and wolves. The U.S. government ended up 2 years later paying $7 million to the Hernandez family as a settlement. Shortly after this, congressional delegation from Texas introduced legislation to reorganize all of the War of Drugs and the U.S. Immigration and Naturalization Service. And U.S. citizens didn't know that we had Marines in deep camouflage patrolling the border. And for a Marine to fire on a U.S. citizen is unconstitutional.
Was it on his land?
It's on his land. So there are all sorts of layers that I only hint at, I only point at by bringing up. And I didn't want Ezequiel to be forgotten.
Do you know how old he was?
He was 18. He just turned 18. He was an honor student in high school. And so with Ezequiel, yeah, it's a deep, deep tragedy. In 2010, there was another person named Eustacio Hernandez who was trying to cross the border at San Diego, Tijuana, and was caught handcuffed. The story goes that he was carrying water when he was stopped, and he was ordered to throw the water away. And his interpretation of throw the water away was to turn the water, the gallon jug, upside down and pour it out. A border enforcement agent took that as a sign of disrespect and escalated his response. They started tasering him. And even after he was down, they tasered and kicked him until he died. In 2014, I encountered a virtual reality work that recreates this event. Noni de la Peña, who conquered the author of the virtual reality creation. So I was at a video game conference when I experienced this work. It's a virtual reality work, and I put on the headgear. And I was given a virtual video camera inside so I could document the work. This video is my documentation of my witnessing of the beating of Eustacio Hernandez. And so it is presented here as in a spirit of sort of appropriation, but also in the spirit of having a conversation with the Speedy Gonzalez piece for Ezequiel Hernandez. These two are related to a piece that I had, a dream piece. had that dream. And then over and over,
separated by several weeks. So I had to do something with it.